if you participate a lot, you know, it makes up for a tremendous amount. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
We get through as many of these as we can. I always, you know, I'm thinking maybe now I need to do like 5 Mary Parker Falls slides eventually. Like 5 sessions.
Yeah, we're not even halfway through.
Yeah, I did it with my group last time, and I thought, I went from 2 to 3 to 4, and I'm thinking maybe I need to do like 5 or 6 in this book. Well, we'll talk about it maybe at the end and see if you guys were like, if you want, we can extend it a little bit, actually. But we'll talk about that. We can actually extend it into another time, next session, if you wish. So I actually don't have a problem with that. I have built some flexibility in the syllabus explicitly for Mary Parker Fall moments. So she's got an interesting discussion here. Final responsibility. Subject, the meaning of responsibility and management require more than one paper for adequate consideration. I have decided to center the discussion on final responsibility. What is that?
Your most important role or job?
What's getting there? Yeah, we're getting there. Okay.
Ultimate authority.
Yeah, ultimate authority. On the termination of policy and supreme control. Executive decision is a moment in a process, the growth of a decision, the accumulation of responsibility, not the final step. Is the one we most need to study.
Did you say the final step is the one that we most need to study, or the decision?
Everything that leads up to the final step is what we need to focus on, not the final step itself.
Okay.
Does that make sense? So study the process behind it, not the final point. And again, when you think about Whitehead, that's his whole thing. When Whitehead says that something is a decision, and when it's fixed, and when you stop for that moment, it's already dead. It's already too late. The only thing that is not moving is something that is dead. That's Whitehead's whole thing. Okay. Does that make sense? So what you need to be focusing on is the build-up to something. It's like a gun that goes off, right? You don't focus on the shot. When the shot has occurred, it's too late. You focus on the picking up the gun, the loading of the gun, the cleaning of it, the aiming, the breathing. And the shot is just the last thing. It's really not much, right? Okay. So we already talked about authority and responsibility derived from function. Right? You want me to go over this a little more? It's not so much, you don't have authority or responsibility because you're placing an org chart. You have it because of what you're actually doing. Okay? Function, responsibility, and authority should be 3 inseparables in business organization. People talk about the limited authority when it is better to speak of the definition of a task. Okay? Your function or your task is what gives you responsibility and authority, not so much, you know, I'm the boss or that kind of thing. Right? It's what you're doing. So far, so good? I already talked about that. Never mind. You guys understand? One more. Do you understand what dure means?
No.
Process and dure?
No.
So there should actually be an accent on there, right? And Mary Parker Fall calls it dure in some of her other papers. Dure is this idea that things don't wholly exist in a single moment in time, right? So if you see something that's going on, that flash, it's actually the flash. It's irrelevant, though, the moment that something happens. It's everything that's led up to it and everything that takes place after it. Don't think of a moment in time, but think of a timeline. This timeline is the concept of dure. So far, so good?
Mm-hmm.
I stole tissues from the bathroom.
So what's the purpose of dure then?
So
not focusing on, like, what do you mean? Instead of focusing on the timeline, instead of just the event.
Yeah, so when you talk about, like, authority or responsibility or something like that, it seems like that's a moment.
Yeah.
Right? But it's not so much the moment itself that's important, it's everything that led up to it and everything that happens after it that's so important. right? It's not the fact that I gave you an order, that's the flash. It's the fact that the order building process was the integration, the discussion, the agreement, and then the order is given, but that's really not that important, the fact that the order was given. It's everything that built up before and then the task is achieved after.
Okay.
This is your introduction to process theory, which you're gonna get a little more of later in this course.
Thanks, Lawson. Thank you.
Does that help?
Yeah, it does.
So we talk about, we already mentioned delegating authority a little bit, right? Authority, she talks about on page, I guess it's 149, delegating authority so that you have the right to all authority and that you, it's useful to you to delegate some of it, but that's not really all that appropriate, right? Authority belongs to a job and stays with a job. Okay. So far, so good? So authority is a task, not a person. Okay, let's talk a little bit about, I think we should be okay here in the idea that authority comes from coordination, not from authority. Responsibility or authority is in a network itself, and then facts have relations. Let's build on both of these ideas, right? So what she says, so let me ask you guys this, what do you take away from that statement even? Responsibility is in a network, and facts have a relation. What does that even mean?
Bless you.
What's that even mean? What is she talking about?
Different responsibilities create a network?
Yeah, that's part of it, right? Let's build on a little more. It's a big part of it, actually. So remember we talked about durée and relationships and how integration occurs? It's not so much about people, but it's about the connections between them. Remember I talked about Whitehead, you build an actual entity, the actual subject tells that story and gets everybody mobilized together? Well, that process of mobilization, thanks, is a process of building networks and connections. Okay? And remember we talked about like multiplying power through working together? And so as you build up higher and higher, you wind up not having an individual directing others, but others through the process of a network being kind of slaves to the situation or, you know, subject to the situation itself. That's what they mean by responsibility is in a network. Responsibility becomes something that is shared between individuals working towards a common task. Does that make sense? So it's not Cindy, it's your fault. It's Cindy, you and I were working together, and you know, together the interpretation wasn't right, and so therefore there's a responsibility that's kind of shared between us.
So you take a the responsibility as a whole as a group instead of just pointing fingers at an individual.
That's right.
If the responsibility is an individual shared by
I didn't hear what she said, I'm sorry.
Responsibility of individual shared by what?
By a network.
Right. Yeah, did it more like your example earlier, where you said that, oh, you have to do this because not for me. You don't have to do this for me. You have to do it because it's part of like the job.
Yeah, that's right. We have some sort of a joint interest to do something together. Mm-hmm. It's something that we share.
That'd be like,
in a way.
There's like a line.
Yeah, and so if the hamburger doesn't get done, you know, who is
Well, I don't know, they use In-N-Out as a, I've had other classes that for some reason use In-N-Out because there's only like one person for a whole 8 hours could be doing just one section.
Right.
Just to make it full.
Like
fast.
An assembly line, right?
Yeah, the assembly line. I mean,
you ever watch like, what's that show? Hell's Kitchen with Gordon
yeah.
Ramsay?
Oh,
right?
Yeah.
And when the scallops aren't right, he
exactly.
just screams at everybody. Right? I mean, he'll pick on people too, but he usually just screams at everybody. He goes, time out, and then he explains, right? But he's getting everybody. Everybody's in his crosshairs, right? Mm-hmm. Facts have relationships. What is she talking about?
I agree.
Yeah, why do you agree? sex out of relationships.
Yeah, that's fine.
Can we give you a hand?
Could, I mean, yeah, hit me.
I saw the statement recently that the administrative head should hold frequent consultation with the heads of all departments, and from the facts thus gained, make his final decisions. Construct his policies. But it's a matter of everyday knowledge to businessmen that their heads of departments pass up to them much more than mere facts. They give interpretations of facts, conclusions therefrom, judgments too, so that they contribute very largely to final determination, supreme control, ultimate responsibility, even to what has been called administrative leadership. In fact, as both information and conclusions are handed up from executives, it is not possible for the head to take or leave them. These conclusions and judgments are already, from a certain extent, woven into the pattern in such a way that it would be difficult to get them wholly out. Hence, while the board of directors may be theoretically the governing body, practically, as our large businesses are now organized, before their decisions are made, there's already been taken place much of that process of which these decisions are but the last step. Okay. Man, there's a lot in there, right?
So what they're saying is like, it's a loophole where information is being feeded through managers and managers, and it goes up the circle, and eventually they're not even facts, they're just basic opinions. And once that information gets fed to the board of directors, they make a decision based off of those opinions. Because technically it's not a fact, right? It's a fact, it's concrete. This phone is black, that's a fact, right? But saying this phone is like titanium or whatnot, or saying this phone is like durable, blah, 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 that's an opinion. So
it's a cool phone.
Yeah, like a cool phone, that's an opinion, right?
Yeah.
Or Mr. Duncan's a legend, you know? That's a fact, right?
I was going to say that as it gets passed up, sometimes you lose some of the facts because they discard them as not being important because they've made that decision.
Right. Or they've provided a very unique interpretation to it.
Right.
And this is, I'm sorry.
The alternative.
Yeah, it's been changed. And this is the idea of a fact having a relation. Okay. Now this is important too, right? Part of it's also the responsibility is in the network, right? The relationships as you're passing up. So whose fault is it? Well, in terms of final responsibility, that whole question is irrelevant. I mean, in some ways the CEO makes a final decision, but he's made a decision based on facts that other people have interpreted for you across a network of people working with him, not for him. I'm using Philadelphian language. And this whole idea of final responsibility, again, all he's doing is pushing the final button, signing the thing. There's a whole process that has taken place. So what matters is the durée, everything that happened before and everything that will happen after the signing of the button, or pushing the button to sign the order, or whatever. It's just a moment, and that's really the least important of everything. Does that make sense? So we mentioned this a little bit already, conferring as a way to enhance agency. Okay, so the idea that, you know, you talk to people and you get a better understanding and this kind of thing. I love, let's see, this example, I'll skip for a second. But again, the idea of conferring, specifics can produce agreement. I mean, this is when we start getting into, you know, how you can generate the facts, understand the real desire, right? Oh, this is the telephone piece. This is the one I was looking for.
Where are you starting?
It's by 160.
Yeah.
160.
Man, I love this case, right? It tells you a lot about telephones, too. So something occurred not long ago to make me look at the organization of the telephone company, which serves the city in which I live. And I seem to find a very interesting corroboration of some of the things I've just been saying. Let me run over the incident and then consider the significance of what was disclosed. One day I sat down at 11 o'clock to telephone my bank. It took me till 11:45 to get it, and I immediately made notes of how this time was spent. I'll give them substance as I wrote them down. 2 minutes were spent in getting a wrong number as someone else answered. 4 minutes were spent ringing the bank, and 4 minutes is an unusually long time for ringing the switchboard for a large bank to go and answer. At the end of 4 minutes, I received the report. No one answers. I then spent 3 minutes getting information and confirming the fact that I had the right number, as it occurred to me that the right number might have changed since I last called the bank. Again, 4 minutes, I endeavored to put through the call, and at the end of that time, received a reply. No one answers. This made 8 minutes that the switchboard of a large bank was apparently dead at the busiest time of day. I had now consumed 13 minutes. I therefore called the chief operator to ask her to get the number for me. For 5 minutes, there was silence. No number and no report. At the end of this time, I asked the chief operator to get the number. Again, silence, no number, and no report on the matter for a further space of 4 minutes. From 11:22 to 11:30, 8 minutes, I spent trying to get the manager of the exchange in which I was making the call, but I could get no response from his office, although I asked 10 or 12 times. At 11:30, I finally got the manager's office, and 8 minutes were then spent by his clerk in trying to locate him. I learned later that the manager was responsible for 4 central offices and was probably going from one to another. At 11:42, I called the head office of the New England Telephone and Telegraph Company, asked for some official of the company hire, and the manager whose office I had been trying to get, and was connected with the superintendent, who instantly got my bank for me at 11:45. And he's good. I suppose the incident then closed, but in the afternoon, a traffic representative in the office where I had my trouble telephoned and asked what had happened, and we had a long talk. Later, the company sent a service representative to see me, and we had a much longer conversation. After that, I talked the matter over with the president of the company, who felt my experience was an instance of exceptionally poor service, and who arranged that I might have the opportunity to see something of the management of the company in action. But I'm not telling this story to illustrate, you know, poor telephone service. On the contrary, before I was through with the matter, I came to think the organization of the telephone company illustrates some basic principles of sound organization. Okay, so what does she talk about in the next paragraph? You know, first of all, people are thinking in terms of their job rather than their position. That's kind of bad, right? Okay, so there was a great degree of hierarchy. Struck my attention with, sorry, a very low importance of hierarchy, which is kind of funny. And then she kind of goes on, and she skips, and she says, "You see, in spite of all my principles, I'm so used to the old way of thinking that I couldn't adjust myself quickly. I kept straight on the search for someone above others instead of asking, whose particular job is this?" And of course, in the telephone company, there was substituted for hierarchy of rank and amount of cross-functioning, okay, which was good. And a third suggestion of some of the things we have been considering, I found a general attitude towards responsibility. Each one seemed to be thinking not so much in terms of to whom he was responsible as to for what he was responsible for. Okay. And then the fourth point. Everyone who I talked seemed to be thinking of his job net just of that of wire chief, manager, superintendent, or whatever he might be, but as the whole enterprise of the telephone service. Blame was also not personal. Number 5. Okay. What do you guys think of this case? Did you guys find it interesting?
Yes.
What do you guys like about it or hate about it?
Well, for them it was important to learn from what happened so that it wouldn't happen again.
That's huge, right?
Yep.
But it sucks that she has to go through all of that just to get the end result and then we're going to do something about it. She talked to so many people just to get like the main big guy to be like, "Oh, we're gonna take care of this."
And that still happens nowadays too.
Oh, yeah. Sure. But it's interesting what she said was that, you know, instead of she was thinking in the old way, right? When she should have just been saying, "Whose job is it to fix this?"
Right.
Talking to a tech or something, she went to the president of the company. Right? And that's what had to happen.
So
said, "Man, I messed up."
She's against that, yeah.
Right, so she didn't even take her own advice.
Yeah, kind of like you were talking about earlier. It's hard. Sometimes it's easy to have the theory, but sometimes you mess up in practice, right?
Because even thanks to the failure, they were able to resolve it or to try to at least better whatever they had.
Yeah, they actually cared. They actually went. They saw her. They talked. They called her. Then they saw her, and then they sent a rep, and then they invited her to come see.
In a way, I think it was okay because she tried to talk to a manager. That was impossible.
So fine, I'll go higher up then.
Yeah. In some ways, she kind of lost, she probably lost her temper. I mean, I can imagine 45 minutes to talk to
She could have walked down there.
Yeah.
Maybe her foot hurt that day.
It's in Boston, it might have been cold.
Yeah, it might have been cold.
No, but just the idea that she spent 45 minutes just with the phone call, it kind of became like a mission.
Yeah, it did.
I've already this invested.
Yeah.
Yeah, let me just go all the way.
I like this example. Anything else you want to talk about before we move on to the next essay? Employee representation. You have to look at the concept, the context of this particular essay. Remember, she's writing in a time when labor unions are kind of a big deal, right? I mean, they still are in some parts of the country, but this is something that's just looking at. She says, I do not see any workers or any of us should be given concessions, privileges. If employee representation is sound organization, sound management, let us have it. If not, we do not wish it, for labor will in the long run be most benefited by the best management. Well, isn't that an interesting idea? What is she saying? What is a concession? Why would she be anti-concession or privilege?
Concession.
Because you're giving something.
Goodbye. You're giving
power without actually doing anything.
That's
without
part of
not
it.
Being like skilled or anything.
Go ahead, I think I'm off.
Warming up.
Doesn't say the same thing as mom.
Oh, I thought concessions was giving something in exchange of something.
It is in some way.
Oh, okay.
But it could be reinforcing the fact that you're giving them concessions every time they want something or they do something wrong. So it's like a go-to fix that may be reinforcing bad behavior.
Yeah, that's a form of compromise in a way, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Right? Well, you don't do what I want you to do, so how about I give you a couple of hours of extra pay and, you know, we'll call it even. I don't really want to pay it. They didn't want to do the thing anyhow. Or just, you know, give them a piece of candy to make them keep going. Now, she talks a little bit about collective bargaining, and she says that, you know, perhaps we should look at it from more of a cooperation style orientation, right? And she talks about one of the most common aspects, you know, there should be some sort of a double track of communication. Employee representation should be considered as an aspect of organization engineering. As we start shifting on to page 171, this is where she starts getting into kind of our anti-democratic sentiment. It says, the most progressive view of employee representation today, as of democracy, is not consent of the governed, but participation. Some of us indeed think that consent is a thoroughly overrated matter. An able writer on industrial questions says that everyone would agree that the free man is consenting man. I cannot agree to that. To say yes implies that the alternative is to say no, and there's not much freedom there. Okay? What does she mean exactly here? Consent and participation, how are they different?
Participation, like ask for an opinion, and the consent is you agree or disagree.
Is it consent more of like, do you want to do it? Do you want this or do you not want that? Doing it at free will.
You're given a yes or no,
right,
like those two points, right? Those two final authorities. Whereas participation, you can contribute to it in your own way, in your own means. That is a form of integration. Yes and no almost implies kind of a domination type perspective, right? Whereas maybe the answer is not yes or maybe it's something totally different.
Well, then he talks about the child driving with his father.
Yeah.
Right? Happy by being allowed to hold the end of, well, the reins.
Yeah, that's it, right?
The vote makes people, many people happy in the same way they think they are driving when they are not.
Yeah, that's right. I love the way she puts that. Yeah, think about that for a second. You're not actually taking an active matter, right? I mean, I may vote for the president, but that doesn't mean I get to contribute in any meaningful way or detract, right?
Especially with the electoral college.
That's right. Yeah. You know, we've seen that a couple times, right? So does this make sense so far? What do we have here? Participation, consent. Yeah, management needs to create sensible working arrangements. Okay, I like this. Now she talks about management is really only sensible working arrangements. Someone else has told me the story of a works committee meeting on a certain morning when there was no work ready for peace workers. If anyone had suggested this was a question of management, the writer tells us, these particular employees would not have allowed the discussion which took place. But everyone was thinking it was merely a question of how to make sure that the peace workers should find the work ready for them when they came in the morning. I like that, though. A big part of management is the creation of sensible working arrangements. Make it easy for people to do their job. Then she starts skipping to conference methods on page 175. Okay. Managers, the fact that managers have to explain to employee representatives a good deal about the running of a business makes them look at some of their problems a little differently. If they cannot make a good case, they see that there are things to be changed or greater efforts to be made. At any rate, they see their problems more clearly when they have to meet employee representatives and place certain situations before them. Of course, conference managers or conferring is a kind of integration. They need to make their demands from managers the ability to make of differences a unifying, not a disruptive factor. Differences as a way to make people come together, not necessarily tear them apart. Does that make sense? So if you can't justify why you're doing something to someone else, there's probably an issue, right? Okay. Let's see, we talked about this. She briefly talks about this total person concept, okay? The primary thing is, I'm looking at page 179. The primary thing he has to learn about his dealings with labor is how to treat with labor, how to use the labor's ability, yes, even labor's aspirations, as someone pointed out, as an asset to the enterprise. Okay? What are they trying to say here? What is she saying here? Use the labor's ability, yes, even the labor's aspiration as a benefit to the enterprise.
What page are you?
178 or 179, depending on how you count them.
Their aspirations being their wants or their dreams, like actually have to somehow be contribute or like integrated into what they do in their job, like going back to that woman that made the toys. Oh, like you had said, like she made toys, but that
yeah.
They weren't made by them, and it had to do
yeah.
back with her.
Yeah, that's right. So you look at what a person is, who they are, what do they want to do, what makes them happy, what makes them tick, and you try to use that for the benefit of the organization. Again, if you can make work and play kind of go hand in hand, you've probably done something pretty good, right? So far, so good? That's what she's discussing here. So far, so good. Move on. Already discussed management of employee relationships and sharing of management. You kind of notice she starts to repeat a few themes throughout the book. I love this idea that she talks about human problems. You know, why should some principle, could it not be that a problem could have been solved by a principle which was not wholly psychological or wholly economic? I'm looking at page 184. Here again, would it not be possible to undepartmentalize our thinking? I think we should do this, undepartmentalize our thinking in regard to every problem that comes to us. I'm going to say, before the end of my talk, I think this could have been done in the stocking controversy. I do not think we have psychological and ethical and economic problems. We have human problems with psychological, ethical, and economic aspects, and many more as you like, legal often. I know a lady who asked her maid to lift a large pot of ferns from one place to another in a room. Little does this woman know that she's long dead, but the story has remained. The maid replied that the lady was stronger than she was, and she thought she should do the lifting. Here you see a problem with an economic aspect and a psychological and an ethical. It could not have been satisfactorily resolved by any one of these disciplines alone. You guys understand what she's talking about?
So you should think out of the box sometimes in different situations.
That's right. Yeah, don't think about it specifically from ethical, economic, or psychological. Look at the fact that all problems are human problems. And if we look at them from a human perspective, we're in pretty good shape. Total person. This is the whole thing with a total person again on page 185, where she talks about whole personalities. He tells us of an integrated unity, functional whole. That's the exact same thing that we talk about with, for example, looking at someone's aspirations and using it for the benefit of the corporation. About democracy and suppression. Let's talk about this idea of perdure on 192, I guess it is.
Wait, we've already
been
the democracy?
Yeah, well, we mentioned it a couple times already. She starts, see, the thing is, this isn't a book in a strict sense, it's a bunch of speeches she's given. So there's some things that just kind of start to repeat. So the whole, do you remember the whole thing about democracy as a form of suppression? When the majority wins, people that are not the majority lose out, and therefore they are suppressed in some way. So the point is not democracy, it's not consent, but it's participation, it's integration instead.
That was
it was in a speech before.
Oh.
You okay?
I have a huge headache.
Can we get some water?
No.
Or Coke? Or
some
water?
No, no. Class is almost over.
Okay.
And it's cold in here too, so that doesn't.
Yeah, I can't do much about that, I apologize.
Yeah, I got you. Let's go Whole Foods, yeah.
All right. Let's see. Just lost my train of thought.
Perdure.
Oh yeah. So we talked about perdure. We talked about it a little bit earlier when we talked about durée. So durée means like a timeline event, and what we're talking about in terms of to perdure means that nothing exists wholly in a single time. Again, it's looking at a timeline. So one man leaves and all the rest becomes a little different. The influence of the board of directors is total, is not the same as it was minus the man's influence, because his withdrawal, by slightly changing every other man, has made the total entity, has made the total different. Every businessman knows the president of a company in relation to one board of directors may be very different from that same president in relation to the board. How does that tie into the idea of perdure? Just because a manager has left does not mean the influence has left. It's kind of like an echo that lasts, right? I mean, I used to laugh, like my first unit in the Army, there was this guy, this major. This wasn't Major Barney, this was before that. And the guy was just egotistical as a jerk. I couldn't stomach him. And he managed to put his name in every single thing. And, you know, he left, and we were still using his slide decks with his name on it for like 8 months afterwards. Like, I just wanted to scream every time I saw his name and that stupid icon, right? But you see, he was an example of perduring. Like, yes, he had gone on to other units and was doing bigger and better things. And yet we were still, in a sense, being ruled by this man. His influence remained. My opinion for the worse.
So you said just because the manager left?
Doesn't mean the influence stops. It's all these processes that go on, right? Does
so
it help?
Like, as she said before, that even though that there's a board of directors, now that some companies don't need it, but their process is still left behind for us to use.
Yeah, that's right. Excellent. Yeah, your influence lasts, right? So that's the whole echo part. Okay, we've already talked about integration being a process, not a product. Is everybody comfortable with that? The general and the particular. Sounds like Plato's theory of forms, doesn't it? That's not a coincidence, by the way. So there's always a process and a product. So business is a we sometimes hear the question of whether general policy should dictate departmental policies or departmental policies contribute to general policy.
Where?
195 at the bottom.
Sure, the first paragraph, second paragraph?
The last paragraph, the very bottom, last sentence on the page.
Oh, okay.
We sometimes tire of hearing the question discussed whether general policy should dictate departmental policies or departmental policies contribute to general policy. There's a deeper truth in either of these, and this is something which I am trying to express to you, namely, that the same activity which is making the whole and parts simultaneously. Is that not the theory of forms? We never put parts together, even when we think we do. We watch parts behaving together. The way they behave together is the whole. I say parts, and other people say factors or elements of total. But when we use any of these words, we must remember that we were talking of activities. It's obviously not a very clear reference to Plato, right? What's happening? Is it the top influencing the bottom, or the bottom influencing the top? Maybe that's not even the right question, right? Exactly what Plato was talking about.
I think they used that in like Follow with the math when he was like explaining it to the boy. And like, you know, two different things, but only they make sense when you put them together, but individually you really don't know anything.
And also the fact that how we interpret, you know, these values that are floating around out there is quite different from the bottom. So are we making values, or the values make us? So far, so good? Let's see. So we've already talked about organizational unity. We've already talked about 1 + 1 = 3. Of course, integrated unities have self-direction. It shouldn't be too surprising, right? The direction comes not from a manager, but from the law of the situation. Yeah, now we're starting to get into a lot of kind of repeats. If you don't mind, I may skip to 214 unless you guys feel uncomfortable with any of these things. I think we've kind of gone over them a few times.
So basically the stuff on your slides would be like for us to go to that page to see it as an example?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
In the long run?
Yeah.
Is that what you mean?
Yeah. So she talks about what the long run is on page 214, but you know, I counted the pages a little different than you guys, so I guess it's 215.
So I kind of have to really pay attention to the pages though, because it's a little off. All right.
Two people said to me at different times, so you have an expression in American which interests us very much, in the long run. I was astonished because I imagined every other nation had not the expression or the equivalent. Of course, English are looking ahead just as we are, yet I think it's rather interesting that our expression, in the long run, has arrested their attention. If American business philosophy is to be known by its recognition of the long run, integration should certainly be part of that philosophy, for emergent values, to use our expression arrived at in the preceding paper, came through integration. What does that mean? Integration has a long-term time horizon, is what she's trying to say. You don't integrate on a short-term basis, you know, disperse, forget it. No, when you integrate, you're looking towards some sort of a long-term positive end goal. So far, so good? I think most of these we have already discussed. Yeah, now I'm starting to remember why I don't do 6 sessions of Mary Parker Paul. She does repeat a tremendous amount. Okay. The only thing that I want you to take away from here is that manipulation is a form of domination. 252. The only reason I'm skipping these other ones is because we've already talked about them. She's mentioned them in other parts of the book.
Did you say manipulation?
Manipulation is a form of domination.
Yeah.
already talked about facts and relationships. Organization occurs over a network, so it is a form of relating. We've already talked about executive relationship and executive learning. Talked about the long one, we talked about it. Okay, here it is, a couple of things that I do want to hammer on. Excuse me, thanks. Alright, so, a couple things that we will look at. Leftover decisions on page 263. Forgot how much she repeats. It is the leftover in a decision which gives it the greatest value. It is a carryover in the decision which helps develop the situation in a way that we wish it to be developed. The ablest of administrators are not merely drawing logical conclusions from an array of facts of the past, which their expert assistants bring to them. They have a vision of the future. The takeaway that I want you to have from this one, again, remember we talked about Whitehead with the actual entity that kind of bursts and then it reforms later? It's that whole concept of an echo. So whatever's left over should be pretty decent. It should be something positive. Because if it winds up being domination or coercion or compromise, the leftover will be bad and it winds up kind of festering. So another thing that she looks at, I want to talk about page 266. And I love this idea that a leader, if we're coming to think that the, sorry, page 267. In fact, several men at the meeting of the American Management Association voiced their conviction that leader and teacher are synonymous terms. If we're coming to think that the leader is not the boss, but the educator, that seems to me an indication that business thinking is taking a long step forward. Is trying to develop men exactly opposite of this. Men themselves with mastery, and such men will give his own leadership worth and power. What do you guys think about this whole paragraph where she talks about this?
Wait, what's the last one you
did?
Did you skip
part
of it?
Yeah, I kind of jumped to the last sentence of the paragraph.
The last
one.
Okay.
Where are we?
Okay, so page 267. Okay. So, we talk about, in fact, several men at a meeting of the American Academy of Management Association, or American Management Association is now the Academy of Management, voiced their conviction that leader and teacher are synonymous terms. If we are coming to think that the leader is not the boss, but the educator, this seems to me an indication that business thinking is taking a long step forward. Our old idea of leadership was that of being able to impress oneself upon others. But to persuade men to follow you and to train men to work with you are conceptions of leadership as far apart as the poles. The best type of leader today does not want men who are subservient to him, those who render him passive obedience. He is trying to develop men exactly the opposite of them, of this. Men themselves with mastery, such men will give his own leadership worth and power. I say that as part of a leader to educate and train. He must know how to do this. He must understand, get others to understand the scientific methods which have been applied to production, marketing, office management, etc., etc.
So you need to lead by example, basically.
Yeah. You got to train your people to be strong, to be, you know, have self-mastery, and
empower them.
Exactly. And empower them to teach them.
Somebody to be able to do that, that would
be a big step. Yeah, don't make them, you know, drones. Make them people that can think for themselves. And the integration gets better because that's more power with.
And also to teach someone who is passive.
What's that?
Also to teach the students that are passive, not just like agitated.
Yeah.
If you teach more the leader or teach a role, they're more capable of probably listening and be more interactive. Than as a boss, like you telling them what to do.
That's right. And you get that give and take, that circular relationship which she keeps hammering on. Mm-hmm. So far, so good. And again, I don't want you guys to feel cheated. These will be on Moodle, but again, you notice it's just kind of repeating the same concepts over and over and over again. Let's see. Oh, we gotta do Mr. Hughes. Let's see. Yeah, okay, so I obviously got a little ahead of myself. I was trying to remember this Mr. Hughes example, but I couldn't remember where it was in the book. So we've just had an interesting example of leadership in Charles Evans Hughes' influence at the Pan American Conference. One reporter spoke of Mr. Hughes' ability to influence the conference profoundly by quiet advice and suggestion, and thought this power due chiefly to his intimate knowledge of Latin American affairs in the face of the continually changing situation developing in Latin countries, to his large knowledge of history, and to his mastery of international law. Another article on the conference stated, by common consent, Mr. Hughes dominated every scene in which he figured importantly, not with the mien of superiority, but with that of the friendly advisor who knew his law and his Latin America. That's her example of leadership. He wasn't showing off, he wasn't threatening anybody, but he was more of a mentor or a coach. A leader as a teacher. And again, I use this example in the Scandinavian countries also, where integration seemed to work reasonably well. It's a low power distance. People have tea and coffee and hang out with their boss, and they call them by the first name, and the boss works as a senior colleague and shows them by example. And that's exactly what she's describing here. So Mr. Hughes has long lived on as influenced through this book. Let's see. I love this. Don't exploit your personality. Learn your job. Bottom of midway through page 274.
271.
Excuse me. Yeah, there's a skip in the pages. There is no page 272, 273, or.
What are you talking about?
Yes, it says 271
up there.
Don't exploit your personality.
Mine's 271, but we're not counting them the same way.
Okay, how does it start?
Right here.
Down here?
Yeah. Oh, you know what's funny? I've had this book for years, and I never noticed that those printers in France didn't put a couple of pages in.
So we have the pages and you don't?
Yeah, isn't that funny? And I've had this, I've been using this book for a long time. I never picked it up. I never noticed that. So there you go. Let's see.
So where is it then?
It's.
So is it 271?
It's 272, I guess.
Where it says the courses in applied psychology?
Yeah, exactly. The same paragraph.
Oh, okay.
Sorry about that. That's not that funny. Learn your job.
Did you find it?
Did you guys find it? Am I good?
Mm-hmm.
She also gives a. Oh, you know, maybe the page fell out. Yeah, now I don't have it. Now I'm really like, that's gonna drive me nuts.
You want me to make you a copy?
No, it's okay. All right, I do want to give one example of Richard Haig again, because I think it's one of the best examples in the book. Okay. I found something a few, I'm looking at page 276. I found something a few weeks ago in a recent novel, which recognizes and expresses this point. The hero of the novel, Richard Haig, was a large-scale farmer in England, and he was a very successful farmer. The author, after telling how Haig got the most out of all his materials down to the very spark with which he lighted a fire, went on to say, and he was the same with people, he got use out of them, though not through being personally exigent in any way. He was always the force of circumstances that seemed to make the demand. Not himself, he merely made it clear to them what it was that needed doing. So little did it seem an affair personal to him that the sheep needed driving off the corn or a message carried into the hayfield that he hardly intervened. He might just call somebody's attention to what was needed, but it was the corn, the cattle, the world that required service, not he. It's a pretty powerful image, isn't it? That's exactly what she's talking about in terms of leadership. some of these others. Okay, we'll do Roan Tree Chocolate, and I think then we'll kind of open it up for broader discussion. That sound okay?
Mm-hmm.
Just trying to remember if there's anything else. Okay, yeah, let's do Roan Tree Chocolate, and we'll just open up for a very broad discussion, because a lot of these examples we've already talked about. Roan Tree Chocolate is one more example. It's one of my favorites. But yeah, I'm famished too, I know. It's starting with talkers. Don't say anything about chicken, please. Especially not fried chicken with hot sauce on it. I don't want to hear it.
Oh, some mashed potatoes, biscuits.
Oh my god.
Hey, can we not talk about food? I'm sorry.
I haven't had dinner, so.
I skipped lunch too, so let's not go there.
Well, you know what, Jay? I walked to school barefoot in the snow both ways today, right?
Right?
It was 81 degrees outside.
It was
miles. Both ways uphill.
Yeah.
No, I'm teasing.
Trades, how do you wear your boots?
Oh yeah, but they've got holes in them to keep,
okay.
Keep you cool, you know.
What? He needs
yeah.
Shoes.
No, they have. Someone put holes in them. Alright, there you go.
Holes in your shoes?
Huh?
I'm sorry.
Never mind.
My boots have holes in them to keep my feet cool in the snow. Alright.
Okay, never mind. Let's get back.
I love this example. It's on page 287. And it really shows the power of a good story, okay, and leadership. Summer before last at the Roan Tree Chocolate Factory in York, I listened to one of the best speeches I have ever heard. When a group of new girls is taken into this factory, they take in about 30 at a time. Mr. Roan Tree, the president, gets to talk to these girls. He tells them what their work is about. He shows them how one person being careless and dipping chocolates may make the young man who takes a box of chocolates to his best girl on Sunday night say, he won't get Roan Tree's chocolates next time. And Mr. Roan Tree shows how this affects far more than Roan Tree profits, how in time reduced sales will mean less employment in York for girls and boys, for men and women. And he goes on from such simple illustrations to show them their place in the industry of England. I don't believe it is possible for those who hear these talks not to feel a close connection with, a certain identification with, the Roan Tree Company. While leadership depends on the depth of conviction and deeper power coming therefrom, it must also be the ability to share that conviction with others. Roan Tree, by his vivid statement of purpose, has found a way of making all his employees share a common purpose. That common purpose, rather than Mr. Roan Tree, is their leader. Is that not awesome?
I believed it.
It's
believable in a way.
That's so much work.
If my husband gives me a box of chocolates, some chocolates from us, be like, I'd be okay, but he'd be like, I'd never go there again. That's the way he is.
But it's the whole facts having a relationship, right? It's the fact that the chocolates, I mean, who cares? It's defective chocolates. But there's an interpretation that goes with that. And this is what a leader does. This is how you integrate. It's by telling the story, by explaining, by showing. Okay, there's this common thing we got to work towards. You don't do it by saying, girls, you're going to get fired if you don't do it. You do it by showing we all contribute to the same thing together. And this is the whole point of integration. I think that is the best way to end our discussion here, is this awesome example of the chocolates. It summarizes everything we've talked about. So, I have gone through a very difficult book with you guys for the past 4 seconds. Do you guys have any questions? Is there anything that's like, I'm not saying that it's not sticking. Did you guys enjoy the book? Love it? Hate it? Never want to see it again? Okay. You got one laughing. You get Darlene's very quiet on the side. It's one of my favorite management books, but don't worry, I won't take it personally. Well, I skipped through a lot of it because, again, she's repeating the same points over and over.
It would be nice if it could be put together without the repetition. You know, like you said, they're lectures, so they kind of overlap.
Yeah, that's the bad part. And the first time I taught this course, I gave a couple of her articles and a couple of articles talking about her articles. And it just wasn't enough. Everybody wanted more Mary Parker Follett. And so that's why I've given, a full 2 sessions or four modules on this, because there's so much to talk about. But I feel like the 4 sessions is about, I feel like it's enough. about enough.
What is this thing?
Well, yeah.
Oh, my former students. Yeah.
I have a question. What kind of experience? Maybe I haven't performed research on her, but like, who is, like, what kind of job or position she held? Like, what's her work experience for her to like write such strong statements?
She did a lot of work with urban poor in Massachusetts, so she's almost like a social worker.
If I'm getting it right, this book was written when women didn't really have
time to write. This book is published in 1940, but it was a collection of speeches. She was already dead in 1940.
Right.
These were things that she gave in the teens and 20s.
Right.
She was very, I want to say maybe she died in the late 20s. I can't remember off the top of my head. But yeah, you're right. And she was denied her degree because she was a woman. She's mostly been forgotten again because of she was a woman, and because of her sexuality, and because she's been accused of being a communist.
Right.
Which is unfortunate, right? But I feel that even though this is almost 100 years old, or more than 100 years old for some of the lectures, to me this is something that I take from, and I try to at least apply it as best as I can. Probably a long shot from Mary Parker Follett, but I try. Right. I mean, again, like we talked about, sometimes people don't want to integrate. Or, you know, sometimes I get, you know, mad at work or something, and I'm like, you know, I need to share, like, what would Mary Parker Follett do, you know?
You're such a teacher.
Yeah.
Such a professor.
Yeah.
Such a prof.
But again, this is probably one of my favorite books. So next time, I'm going to double check with Lewis. I put in printing orders already, and so hopefully you guys have a Monday class?
Yes.
Okay. Hopefully the stuff will either be here for you Monday or Tuesday. I'm just going to double check.
Oh, okay.
So for your next reading, now if you do want to get a jump start, okay, you can. You're going to have, so session A, you're going to have scenario building again. So make sure you watch the videos. Since you've never seen them before, you definitely want to watch them. And so we'll do kind of a group thing with that, so that's kind of easy. And then the session B, you're going to read Principles of Scientific Management by Frederick Taylor, which she's actually talking about in this very book, so this won't be too much of a...
So is there a PDF you can put on Moodle and then...
Yes, because it's open source, I can. So the printouts may or may not be back by Monday or Tuesday.
No, that gives us more time.
But I will, I can't, that PDF I actually can without any sort of legal penalty. That one I can, so I'll put that on there. It's about a 70-page book, but again, it's written in very simple English, because you have to remember, Taylor was an engineer, he was not sociologist or whatever. So it's very, very simple, very direct. I do want to say before you read Taylor, I don't endorse the way that he speaks per se. He's a little bit racist. He's very condescending. You have to remember this is someone of an educated elite coming from that time. A lot of these workers and immigrants are like Pennsylvania Dutch, so guys coming from Germany and these places, and he's real mean to them. But that's part of way management thought was at that time. So I'm just kind of giving you a warning. But his ideas are so important for management education, I think I'd be failing you guys if I didn't have you read it.
What's the purpose of that part of management?
Oh, good question. So we're shifting from management theory, and so there's kind of like a little bit of a transition. So it's a little bit of management theory, but now we're shifting more into operations. Yeah, so we'll do some Taylor, and then I'm gonna show you. So this is kind of the direction that we're gonna go for the next couple of weeks. You're gonna get Taylor. You're going to read Principles of Scientific Management. Now, the 23rd, you'll have a little extra time because I have a conference in Palm Springs and I can't be here. I'm presenting that day. So what I'll do for some of you guys that are a little low on participation, I'll put a couple of my papers up on Moodle. And if you want to summarize one of them, I'll give you some extra points. So you can be engaged with my research even if you're not witnessing my presentation. Not mandatory, but I'll...
Extra credit.
Yeah, extra credit, exactly. And so then the week after that, you're going to see how Taylorism didn't work very well in the Soviet Union and how it didn't work very well in France at the same time. So there's kind of a cross-cultural aspect of taxes.
So you're not here on the 23rd.
The 23rd.
That's and
right.
Then the 30th is spring break.
Oh.
So two weeks of no classes.
Two weeks of no class. My goodness.
Wow.
I'm going to miss you, Professor.
I miss you guys too.
Except for you.
I want to go to Bo's Steakhouse.
Buffalo
wings and Buffalo. Oh my gosh, so good.
Chocolates. Yeah. No,
23rd, right?
Yeah, 23rd. And then so when we come back, yeah, it'll be, you'll look at Taylor and how it didn't work in the Soviet Union, how it didn't work in France during the 20s. And then the week after, you'll see the modern evolution of Taylorism, which is Lean Six Sigma. And that's what we'll talk about.